what happens when you look at creativity through the lens of therapy and vice versa? You have Creativity in an Ever-Changing World with Dr. Judy Bloom and Richard Skipper. In every episode, they come together with amazing artists who prove that, with just a little ingenuity, we are all creative beings and that the gifts lie within despite the challenges of the outside world. And now, here are Dr. Judy Bloom and Richard Skipper.
Happy Tuesday, everyone. Do not check your calendars. Now, normally, we do our show on Thursdays, but there's been a lot of scheduling issues with Dr. Judy Bloom and myself this month. But today, we're doing a very special edition of this show today, and Dr. Bloom is waiting in the wings, and we have an amazing cast because we are going to be celebrating a show that I have fallen in love with called Chasing Rainbows. And I have been chasing this show for quite some time. I saw it several years ago, originally at the Goodspeed Opera House, and then I saw it at the Paper Mill Playhouse, and I will go anywhere to see this show. It's such a loving homage to the early years and the trajectory of Judy Garland's early years from Frances Ethel Gumm into The Wizard of Oz. And it's done with such love and precision, and such an amazing team of people have brought this together. And several of those people are all waiting in the wings to tell you their amazing story today. And we're going to be celebrating them. But as we've done all this month, we begin today with the one and only Judy Garland. Here she is. And on the other side, we'll meet the other Judy. Here she is.
Me, I heard a melody, it haunted me from the start. Something inside of me started a symphony. Sing with the strings of my heart. Was like a breath of spring, I heard a robin sing about a nest set apart. All nature seemed to be in perfect harmony. Sing with the strings of my heart. Your eyes made skies seem blue again. What else could I do again but keep repeating through and through, I love you, love. I still recall a thrill, I guess I always will, I hope we'll never depart. But dear, with your lips to mine, oh, rhapsody divine, sing with the strings of my heart. Skies seem blue again. What else could I do again but keep repeating through and through, I love you, love you. I still recall a thrill, I guess I always will, I hope twill never depart. Dear, with your lips to mine, oh, perhaps a deed of mine. Sing with the strings of mine. Sing with the
Hello, Judy. Welcome back. It's so good to see you. I mean, I always begin my shows by asking who or what are you celebrating today? But I have to say that after 2 years, I am celebrating the fact that you and I finally met this month.
I agree.
Yes, it was great to finally meet you and Tom. And we had such a great time here in New York. So and thank you for everything. We had a great time.
So did we. We enjoyed absolutely every minute of it. And you really gave us a taste of New York that we wouldn't have had otherwise.
Well, thank you. We are celebrating Judy Garland all this month. And I want to ask you, I'm hoping that you are a Judy Garland fan as well, especially today. And what is it about Judy Garland that resonates with you? And do you have a favorite moment in her career, whether it be film, concert, or something that stands out the most for you?
Well, I grew up with The Wizard of Oz. So, that was a staple at our home. So that's what certainly resonates the most with me. And, I think it's just, she represents hope and struggle and, wanting acceptance, right? Wanting love, searching for it all the time. Still believing that it's possible. I think that's what, when we talk about rainbows, what are rainbows? Rainbows are, our hopes and dreams, right? So she is the rainbow. And I think that's really what keeps her being the icon that she is, at 100.
Well, maybe those are the themes that we're going to be talking about today. And I also want to mention to everybody who's watching that we are going to do a giveaway today. I'm going to give away a Judy Garland item. And the winner is going to help choose the item based on the guest that I've had all this month. And all you need to do is respond with any questions with the hashtag vision. And as I mentioned, this incredible show, Chasing Rainbows, The Road to Oz, all of those themes, of course, are in this. And I'm going to bring on the book writer for that. And that's Marc Acito, who is here, who's going to position himself. Marc, so welcome to the show, first of all. Marc, I have a good fortune of seeing the growth of this show, not only from Goodspeed to Paper Mill Playhouse, but it didn't start at Goodspeed. I know that it started at Flat Rock and even before that in workshops. So first of all, thank you for being here. And I know that Tina Marie, who's going to be coming on right after you, will tell us about how it really began. But when you were brought on board to write the book, where did it begin for you?
As Dr. Judy just said, it was the rainbow. Tina Marie Casamento Libby, who is our conceiving producer, met with me and she was talking about her experience of Dorothy as an orphan, always wondering where Dorothy's parents were, and that when she sings Over the Rainbow, that her interpretation was always that Dorothy was singing to her parents and the idea that they were in heaven. And I had never met, other than Salman Rushdie, of all people, with whom I shared a green room on a book tour, and Tony Kushner, with whom I walk my dog, Tina Marie is the only other person who actually had that insight into The Wizard of Oz as an allegory for the afterlife. And in my particular case, I saw The Wizard of Oz for the first time when I was 3, which was 1969. And shortly thereafter, Judy died. And I remember my father reading the obituaries in the morning, which is what he does every morning. And he said to me, "Hey, look, there's this, you see this picture? Do you remember Dorothy from The Wizard of Oz?" And I said, "Yeah." And he said, "She's dead." And because my family didn't believe in, sort of sugarcoating the truth. But in my mind was this idea of going over the rainbow as an idea for heaven. And I associated those things. And when Tina Marie shared that experience, and it goes a lot deeper from our own personal experiences with loss, I just knew in that moment, my whole life has been a preparation for this particular show in this particular moment with this particular woman. And we've been at it ever since. And every time we're troubled by it, I remind myself and others of that intuitive sense that we all had that this was something that felt serendipitous.
Well,
so we just always return to that.
I'm going to share something with you. I was 8 years old when Judy died. And I remember my cousin coming over and breaking the news that Dorothy had died. And and I even talk about this in my one-man show. I threw myself on the floor and I screamed, "I can't go on." And I was crying and my mom grabbing me. Judy, you may want to analyze me on this. My mom grabbed me and said, "You don't even know this woman. Why are you acting this way?" But I felt like my whole world was crashing down around me because The Wizard of Oz was this, it was a family event for me because the family came together every year to watch this. And I thought in my 8-year-old mind that because she was now gone, that I would never see the movie again. And that was the way that my mind processed it. And that was traumatizing to me at that time, that not only was she gone, but everything else that she was about was gone as well.
Well, and that's the thing I think that young people today don't understand is that, you know, it was once a year. And if you missed it, you missed it. That was it.
It was an event.
And it, in that regard, it was like a rainbow. That, you know, you just, the rainbow is there. And if you catch it, you catch it. And if you don't, it's, you know, it's gone in an instant. And I knew as well, even though her life was full with so much struggle and ended so sadly, that I would be able to tell the story of her youth because of that metaphor. Because the idea that the song Over the Rainbow is neither happy nor sad. It just says, why can't I get over the rainbow? It's an existential question that we all live with.
Well, I want to bring Tina Marie on because...
Yeah, please.
Yes, absolutely. Hello, Tina.
And hi.
First of all, welcome. You know, I'm assuming, I think, well, I'm, I, no, I know I'm older than you are. I'm sure that your first introduction to Judy was also through The Wizard of Oz. Am I correct?
Yes.
And is that also the hook for you as far as who she is and what she's about? And when did you get to know her beyond The Wizard of Oz?
Well, you know, honestly, I was a teenager and I was so obsessed with, as Mark was saying, as a 7-year-old watching, you know, Dorothy and saying, you know, where are her mother and father? And then she sang Over the Rainbow and I was like, oh, I know where her mother and father, because I had lost my mother at a young age. And so I felt like I really connected with this girl. And so after that, I wanted to continue learning about the actress playing Judy Garland playing Dorothy, because I think I knew I wanted to be in the business at a very young age. I loved going to the theater and I had some talent for singing and theater, and I was a professional actress for a really long time. And as a teenager, I thought, well, the best way to start is to read biographies about Judy. And I read this biography, and when I read that her father passed away at age 14, I was like, I knew it. I knew that the actress playing Judy, playing Dorothy, had a connection to that song in a really special way, because her father passed away just before she made that movie. And I felt an instant connection with her. And then it was like, I just wanted to read the biography of her life. I always wanted to go back to the beginning after Meet Me in St. Louis. I would go back to the beginning. But then I just started watching all of her movies. And at that time, I would go to Blockbuster and rent all the movies and just watch all the Andy Hardy films and all the movies that she did later in life. And I just was really quite, I felt very connected to her in a weird way.
But one thing that I want to add, not only did, you know, her father die just on the precipice of her success, but her mother remarried within seconds, it seems like, of her
father
passing away. Yes.
1 year.
In a child's mind, that is seconds. And it is, you know, and that's traumatizing for a child to feel that her father is being replaced so quickly, which is what she was feeling at that time.
And I feel like she had a very special connection to her father. I mean, I find, you know, Mark and Dennis and David, and we've all talked about this, that her father, you know, was a man in the 1930s who was bisexual and had to hide it. And so society wanted him to be something he was not. And the studio wanted Judy to be something she was not. And I feel like the two of them had a very special connection. And I don't find it, you know, at all surprising when you later learn that even though people didn't really know about her father, that she spent the rest of her life looking for him and that she just became a beacon of hope for the gay community and just an icon. So much about that is fascinating to me.
Well, I want to say to both Tina and Mark, and this gives me the opportunity to say this, as a gay man, and as a subject that is so delicately treated, thank you both for the way that you handle it in the show. Wow. Because it is done with such respect, and it's done in such a way that is not salacious, or it was handled so well that it's not like you're hit between the eyes with it, and it's not a major focal point. In some productions, it could have been done in such a way that could have been cringing to the audience. Mm-hmm. And I applaud both of you for the way that you handled it. So thank you.
I just want to say, Tina Marie, that gave us a guiding principle, I'd say, I probably from day one, I think, was the notion that this is a woman with 3 living children and with grandchildren. And that, Tina Marie, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but it was, if you want to say what it,
she still has 3 living children and grandchildren. It was very, very important to me that I let the family know what we wanted to do and that we honored the family. It was very important that we told her story in a way that was respectful to her memory. And that's, you know, we really wanted to celebrate her and celebrate the early part of her life, which people know very little about. They know a lot about what happened after Wizard of Oz. And that's when people became fans. But like what happened before, to me, is such a heartfelt, incredible human story that is relatable and compelling.
Now, I consider, I mean, when you're working with a great company, such as the one that you have created, both at Goodspeed and Paper Mill, and I'm sure at Flat Rock as well, it becomes family. So everyone in the wings are family, but there is someone in the wings that is more family to you, Tina, than anyone else here. Do you want to introduce that person?
I assume you're talking about David Libby.
Yes, of course.
He is the arranger and has composed a lot of the original music for the show and has done the orchestrations. The incredible, talented jazz man himself.
Yes. Hi, David. Welcome.
Hey, Richard.
So, I mean, you both, you live together, you collaborate together. Is it Judy 24/7 in your household?
Well, there are periods of over the past, you know, 6-7 years that certainly it has been Judy 24/7. It's been a wonderful journey for me, an ever deepening appreciation of Judy. And you know, when I was when Tina Marie first approached me with the music, and I started to do a little digging into some of the, of course, I was also, like everyone has talked about, just completely enthralled with The Wizard of Oz. In fact, I remember having a really, a mind-blowing moment when I realized that Judy Garland was not Dorothy, that those were two separate people. You know, for me, they were, it was really just, it was almost like a Santa Claus moment when you find out, you know, wait a minute, that's not an actually Dorothy. No, that's an actress who plays that. So, you know, and that the movie, of course, occupied a, like anybody, I think, who grew up in 20th century or since the movie was created, it just occupies a huge place in the cultural imagination. But I did not know as well her other work, including the Andy Hardy stuff and some of the earlier things and even some of the later things. But what really appealed to me when I started digging into and doing the research and digging into her movies was just because, as Tina Marie mentioned, I'm a jazz musician by you know, like that's my I guess you would say that's my first language, you know, musical language. And so that isn't really represented in The Wizard of Oz. You know, you have these incredible ballads, but you wouldn't necessarily say it's a jazz score per se. But if you go back and you look, start looking into the earlier things, and you find that, she had an innate sense of swing and rhythm that is just infectious, and it just immediately won me over as soon as I started viewing those things. And as far as the score itself goes, as it evolved, we sort of discovered that what kind of it revealed itself to us was that the numbers in which she's performing, say at an audition or you know, at the Shrine Auditorium or you know, any number of like when she's actually there, then we treat that as sort of a period piece, like a jazz number. But then in the moments that are more book oriented, where it's more of a storytelling thing that is not a performance per se, it's a character having a journey, an emotional journey, then we found out that, you know, we had a lot more latitude with that stylistically, and we could, invoke some other styles and let whatever the dramatic moment and the emotional moment happen to be in the story of Judy dictate to us, you know, where we go with the music. So it's really, it's been a, you know, it's been a great collaboration and journey with Tina Marie, particularly. You know, Tina Marie particularly approached me with this catalog of songs. And, you know, because I am sort of a more of a traditionalist, I'd say, in some respects, I would have probably approached the music much more with a much more true to period feel approach. But she really helped me, guide me as far as like the actual emotional tone of it. So when, you know, for instance, a good example of that would be I'm Always Chasing Rainbows, which I always sort of, you know, I always loved that song, but I also very much thought of it just thought of it as a very almost sentimental kind of, you know, slow ballad. It's kind of wistful and said, I'm always chasing rainbows, you know, and sort of that kind of a feeling. And that was not the moment stylistically that we wanted at all, emotionally we wanted at all. And particularly Tina Marie helped me, guide me towards that. And so it became a different arrangement than I think people have heard. And I think that's true with certainly other songs like, If I Only Had a Brain and some of the other songs that, you know, I think that one of the things that is appealing for folks is that there are some surprises there musically.
Oh, great surprises. Yeah. I want to bring on our next guest because he absolutely helped shape the show. I don't think that your director choreographer can hear what I have to say about him before I bring him on. But Dennis Jones happens to be one of my favorite director choreographers, bar none. And I'm just going to say this because I was having a conversation. I'm going to drop a name. I was having a conversation with Cheetah Rivera. And I said, she said that with all due respect to everyone who's working now, with a lot of choreography in a lot of shows now, you can change the costumes, put them in a different show, and you don't have a sense of who the choreographer is anymore. But with Dennis Jones, the choreography is specific to the show, and it is so perfectly put into each show. When I see a show, I know that Dennis Jones has his stamp on it, and he is the perfect person for that show and the perfect person to come on right now. And he didn't hear anything I said. So Dennis, welcome to the show.
Thank you. I didn't listen to one word of it, Richard. not a thing.
I'm such a fan of yours, so I'm thrilled you're here.
Oh, well, you're very kind, and it's so nice.
So thank you. So when you were first approached to be involved in this production, obviously there has to be something that's going to attract you. What was it that first attracted you to this project?
I, like the rest of my creative family have very specific, you know, connections to the Wizard of Oz and to Judy Garland. I was just enjoying hearing others' stories, which I have heard before, but I could hear again and again. I was also one of those people who watched it once a year on television and looked forward to it so much that the fact that it was only on once a year, I had a tape recorder. And so one year I literally just like held the microphone up to the TV so that I could record the entire thing on like a cassette so I could listen to it in the other, you know, 12 and a half months, whatever. So I felt a deep connection to it as so many people do. And it's really exciting to see the way it just continues to speak to generation after generation. As a kid, I would not call it a minor obsession. I would call it actually a major obsession with MGM musicals of the golden era. Like that was something that really, that style that really spoke to me and a kind of a level of emotion and color and vibrancy and wit and dance and like all of the components that made those movies so special really kind of like jumped out at me from the television and spoke to me. So certainly being involved in a musical that, you know, not only explores the early life of Judy Garland, but kind of celebrates that genre of film at the same time, you know, I was overjoyed to talk to the team about getting involved with it. And you know, one of the things too, like I knew this on some level as a kid, but it's something that I continue to appreciate as an adult, is just what a fine actor Judy Garland was. I mean, the voice is sensational. I mean, but what she does to those songs is she lives within them. She speaks to audiences through them. It's never notes on a page. It's the sort of the breadth of human experience that she brings to every single word that she sings. And really, I think every word that she utters on camera, there's just something about her that is so deeply truthful. You never feel like she's either phoning it in or distanced from it or playing a style for style's sake. I mean, she is always speaking the truth. And that's one of the things that I think is so powerful about this musical and about the work that this incredible team of people have created, is it really, I sort of identifies the parallel between, you know, Dorothy Gale as a character and Frances Gum as a human being, and that her connection to that character and her deep belief in creating something that was authentic and truthful was essential to her. And that is why that performance is what that performance is. So I think the musical just really very smartly and very movingly sort of takes us to the moment where she really like makes this very strong case for who Dorothy Gale is based on her understanding of that character. And quite frankly, the rest is history. Sorry, that was a bit of a tangent. I don't even remember.
No, that's absolutely perfect.
Well, that's why I said yes.
But I want to go back to something that Tina just said about the children and the grandchildren and the fact that she does have family members. We would be remiss if we did not acknowledge John Fricke and his involvement in this, because he is the torchbearer, you know, for keeping Judy's legacy alive and celebrating her. How did you and John Fricke get involved, Tina? And what has he brought to the table, Mark, Tina, David, Dennis, in terms of how all of you have worked with him in terms of what he's brought to the table?
Well, John was one of the first people I approached when I got the rights to all the music. EMI Music Publishing, you know, when I approached them, they were looking for ideas for their catalog. You know, I've always wanted to be a storyteller. And this was obviously something that I thought somebody would make a musical about years ago, and nobody did. So anyway, I approached John and, you know, met with them, and he said, I'm going to warn you before we meet that many people have wanted to do a musical about Judy, and it's a terrible idea. And then we met, and I told him about exactly how I wanted to plot out the show. And he said, until now, it's been a terrible idea. But like, and he loved it because I wanted to use the songs and the lyrics to tell her story. And I'm, you know, I'm obsessed with lyrics. I'm obsessed with the way music can tell a story in just the emotional tones and the way that it ebbs and flows. And I, you know, when I was an educator, I was passionate about sharing insight about how lyrics are interpreted. And when you look at the lyrics of the, every song was chosen based on the lyrics. And then it was passed on to David with an idea about what the musical tone and emotionality was. And then he kind of developed it from there. So, you know, John was really, you know, somebody who I wanted to have on so that we did stay, as John would put it, in the emotional truth of her story, and also present something that the family would be comfortable with and pleased with. And John is definitely a big part of our world.
Anyone else?
We call him Frickopedia. So you know, anytime we need information, he's the go-to guy, and he gives us a level of truth that we're always seeking to inform the story. But David, you were about to say something.
Well, I was just gonna say, I mean, he's really part of the family. I mean, he's very much been with us for a long, long time. And for me, I'll just say that his enthusiasm for the show has been, you know, specifically for me, I've taken some chances musically, not to stay traditionalist and purist and really, you know, a stickler for every little note being period and just exactly stylistically from 1937 or whatever. Taking some chances and having some latitude about how we handle the music, that and his sort of overwhelmingly positive response to that approach has really sort of helped me, and I think all of us sort of keep going in that direction. Of course, you know, there's always, along the way, there's always improvements to be made, adjustments to be made, things that can be better. And I don't want to overstate it, but just John's overall support and positive energy for the show has just really been a great energizer for us.
That's great. When I started doing, I mean, all this month, all of my shows have been Judy-centric. And when I first got the idea of devoting this month, because this is the 100th birthday of Judy, the first person that I reached out to was Karen Mason. And I reached out to Karen because not only did I see her in Chasing Rainbows, but a couple of years ago, before COVID, I saw her along with Joan Ellison, Debbie Gravett, and Lorna Luft, do Judy Garland's Carnegie Hall concert. And I've seen Karen do so many of Judy's songs over the years. And talk about lyrics. I mean, she is a singer's singer, and you're lucky to have her in your show. And I'm thrilled that she said yes. When I asked Karen to do the show, it was Karen's idea that we do this.
So, great. So you get to blame me for everything.
Karen. So Karen, thank you for being here. And she's in Cape Cod. You're getting an award, I think, on Saturday night?
Saturday. I know. This is what happens when you get old. They just start giving you a lifetime achievement award. So I'm getting one in Provincetown. And what a beautiful place to get an award.
I'm going up to see her. So I'll be there. So, Karen, how did you get involved with Chasing Rainbows?
Well, actually, I think I auditioned, but I think Tina Marie was the one. I had actually, she was the one who convinced me to come and be part of it. She was, she twisted my arm. I had gotten an offer to go do something else, some other show. And she called me. I mean, this is what every actor, singer prays for in their lifetime, in their career, is to have somebody want you so badly that they call you personally and try to convince you to do the show. And she said, you won't regret it. You won't regret it. And honestly, I never did.
Bought her with a scone.
That's right. I can be bought with food. I guess this is the lesson.
Now, you are the person who is in there twisting Mayor's arm and saying, you know, get her into the studio and making it happen. And you're leading this, the kids in the schoolroom. You're the, you know, you are, I mean, you're just incredible in the show. You've got great numbers to do.
I do. Well, they, you know, I've been very lucky. So many ways I personally love the arrangement, the song that I get to sing is Kay Coverman. It makes me very, very, very happy. And as Ma Lawler, Dennis was very wise to have me kind of step back and let everybody else dance. And yeah, that's a very wise thing. And, but I love what I get to sing and what I get to do in the show. I love it. It's just a total joy and a total gift, and to work with all of these amazing people. It doesn't get much better than this.
Karen, I mentioned earlier that I was lucky enough to catch you in Asbury Park when you were part of that incredible Garland celebration with those original arrangements of Judy's concert at Carnegie Hall. When you're singing those arrangements, hearing those original orchestrations on stage, what is that experience like for you? And do you feel this the ghost of Judy hovering around you when you're singing those arrangements are just so phenomenal.
Yeah. Well, what is great about the brilliance of those arrangements is that they kind of guide you through, if you pay attention to them, they guide you and support you, which is what a great arrangement should do. And those orchestrations, you know, for the type of singer that I am, they couldn't be more thrilling. And I grew up, listen, I admit I've stolen from, you know, the best. And I stole from Garland and Streisand, but I'd say probably Garland was the first influence on me. So to have known those arrangements for my whole life, and then to be able to sing with them, it's beautiful. And seriously, those arrangements just, you know, that's the great thing about a brilliant arrangement. And what David has done with the show is exactly that. What it does is it supports you and lifts you into a whole other plateau, a whole other stratosphere. All you have to do is just sing the tune and the rest of it is done for you. And, you know, it's great to be able to do those arrangements.
So let's face it, you've got a great book. You've got a great show. You've got a great director choreographer. You've got great arrangements. If you don't have a great Judy, it just ain't going to work. And you hit pay dirt. So, and I know the story, but before I bring Judy on, Tina, do you want to tell how you found her?
Yes. So we hadn't even started doing much with the show. I mean, we were still working on the book. We were still trying to figure out where the show was going. And I go a lot to Broadway Artists Alliance is a wonderful program that Jennifer Johns Grasso runs and is a fantastic place for kids to learn from, people in the industry. And I was there as a panelist, and this kid gets up and she is dressed like in practically period clothing. It was modern clothing, but she had a style with these cat eye glasses. And I just thought she was so interesting. And then she sang Zing with the Strings of My Heart. And her voice was incredible. And what was so fascinating is so many of the young people who come in and audition, they want a belt like Elphaba, or they have just a propensity to get up there and just scream their highest notes. And this actress just naturally sang in her own voice and this beautiful vibrato. And it was, she just won me. And then I looked at her picture and I held it up next to a picture of Judy. And I literally wrote on her headshot, Frances, because I wasn't looking for a Judy Garland imitator. I was looking for Frances Gum. I was looking for a young girl. And then her name was Ruby. Didn't hurt.
No. No. And here she is, Ruby Rakos. Ruby.
Hi.
Ruby Rakos.
Oh, nice.
Ruby. And Ruby knows I'm such a fan of hers. She thinks I'm a stalker.
Oh, please.
A couple of years ago, I was looking, when I did my one-man show, when I wanted an opening act, I called Ruby, and she came in, and I just love her so much. I'm such a fan of hers. So Ruby, this journey has been so great for you. And, you know, as happens, you're growing up also. And, it's like she's so perfect in this role.
I'm going to stop you right there. Because nobody ever asks if Michael Wartella has outgrown the role.
I did not say he's outgrown the role. I will not say that. And Michael and Ruby are perfect together. So, Ruby, when you got the call that you were going to do this role, because I know that not only are you brilliant in this role, but you also happen to be a huge Judy Garland fan.
Well, actually, I wasn't a big Judy fan until I started working on the show. There was never like a big, like, you have the part moment. Like, this has been like little increments of like, oh, I'll do this little table read. I'll do this little reading. And it's just like built up. But like the big moment was just coming to audition. And I had like 3 weeks notice. And, you know, I was given like a list of songs to prepare. And I spent those 3 weeks, like, I read biographies. I watched a ton of her early movies. I was still in high school. I was a senior in high school at the time. And so while I was waiting for the bus into the city every morning, I would listen to Judy's recordings of the songs I had to do. And I would sing along with them at the bus stop. Trying to, just copy her cascades and her phrasing. And honestly, that 3 weeks is the bulk of the research I've done on this role. It was just like a very intense 3 weeks leading up to that initial audition.
As I used to teach, clues and sources. You have to follow the clues and get to your sources so you know how to go to your audition. And she freaking nailed it.
Well, I'm curious. I always thought that you were a huge Judy fan based on things that I had seen about you and read about you. So this is a revelation to me.
I became one. Okay. I'm a reformed Judy fan, yeah.
Like she sang Zing just because she loved the song.
Yeah.
And I naturally heard what she naturally had. And I said to her, I have to tell this. I said, has anybody ever told you that you look and sound like Judy Garland? And she looked at me in her wise years and said, I only know about old Judy. I never thought about young Judy. And I was like, well, that's fascinating.
And then once you learned about, yeah, I'm curious to know, Ruby, once you then did in those 3 weeks look at young Judy, did you say, oh yeah, I get it. I can see why people might think that about me.
Oh yeah. Or, I mean, and when I look at photos of Judy, I mean, as a child, she looks like my mother. And then as an adult, she looks like my grandmother. So like, I immediately saw myself in her once I got into, you know, her early career, you know, Love Finds Andy Hardy, you know, Thoroughbreds Don't Cry. You know, I immediately felt a connection, and reading those biographies and like learning about her childhood, I found a lot of parallels. Like, I was a child actor, obviously not to the degree that she was, but you know, I felt a lot of these, you know, parallel connections.
I did too. And when I was reading those biographies as a kid, I was convinced that I was the secret love child of Peter Allen and Liza Minnelli. And that I, because I'm sure I didn't belong in my family. Yeah. But the, you know, the dates line up, and I just thought, you know, yeah, I don't belong in this family. I belong in that family.
Well, for me, it was Clark Gable. And Clark Gable's son and I were born the same week. Oh. So no. I was convinced that there was a mix-up at the hospital. So, Ruby, what did you learn about yourself playing Judy in this show that surprises you the most as an actress?
Well, I mean, I started working on the show when I was 16. So I had never played, you know, the lead role in anything. I'd not done much, you know, I'd done a couple middle school musicals. And then I was in Billy Elliot on Broadway as a kid in the ensemble, but you know, that's a very different experience. So I pretty much learned how to be an actor and how to be, you know, a professional singer who, you know, I learned how to take care of my voice. I learned how to, you know, lead a show. You know, I learned a lot about myself as a performer through the show. Yeah, and you know, learned, I was like, oh, maybe I know what I'm doing. You know, maybe I can do this.
Okay. And, well, that is the interesting thing too, as we've watched Ruby develop as an actor. Fricky says this all the time. He says, God, she gets younger every time she does it. And it's that thing about you know, about playing Juliet. You know, if you get a 14-year-old to play Juliet, she doesn't have she's the right age, but that actor typically doesn't have the life experience to be able to actually convey the character. And we find that the more Ruby matures, the more she understands just the, you know, the depth of what's necessary. And so the performance not only gets better, but also gets even more specifically focus. Youthful. Yeah. So yeah. It's a weird paradigm that we get.
And she's an innately naturally talented singer and an intuitive human, and I think she has great access to her emotional life, and I think that she brings that to the role. You know, it's wonderful.
I want to ask, because we've just, and we're not completely out of it, COVID, how has this affected the journey or the trajectory of this show?
Wow, it's immensely affected us. And I'm going to try to be Pollyanna about it, because I think that in a way, the time during COVID was a great time for us as a creative team to really have the time to examine the piece, examine what, I mean, I've always watched every production and been squirming in my seat about things that I would like to address. And I also was very fortunate that we brought on a new partner. I have a new partner who sees what I see and has been monumental in helping us continue to forward the show and inspiring Dennis to lead us through a new mission statement and a vision statement to forward the show. Hunter Arnold has been a fantastic partner, and basically we, you know, spoke all during COVID and then, you know, continued to develop the show with the creative team. I also went through some crazy health issues during COVID. And I'm happy to say that I'm a breast cancer survivor, and going through that during COVID was crazy, but also serendipitous, because I think it really gave me such determination and inspiration to use this time to reconnect with the original, you know, idea of what we wanted to do.
Judy, do you have any questions for any of our panelists?
Ruby, I'm wondering what you're itching to do next after Judy.
I don't know. You know, the pandemic has sort of like completely sort of, you know, changed. Yeah, probably what I want to do. Like, I don't know if after Judy, like, there is more acting. I don't know. I've been going to college, getting my associate's degree during the pandemic. You know, I'd like to get my bachelor's degree in who knows what. You know, I don't know. I think it's like sort of pushed me to, you know, be a more well-rounded person. You know, because I've been doing this since I was 12. Like, jeez, you know,
did just it, a couple know. Of years, just a couple of years. So I'm going to do a giveaway. And while I'm giving everyone a little time, I'm going to go around. The word is vision. So I'm going to pull this off because I want to see everyone's faces here. I'm just going to do like a little round robin. And I've got some questions that I'm going to ask each of you to give everyone a little time to tap in. And then each of you will be given a chance to give your final word today. It can be about something that we talked about today that you want to build upon, something that we didn't talk about that you wish we had, or just any final word that you want to leave everyone with today, whether it be about your particular show, something coming up, or about Judy, or anything, or a Lifetime Achievement Award. It could be about anything. So I'll start with you, Marc. What is the best single piece of advice that you have ever received in this business?
You know, I'm just going to go with the very first thing that came to mind, which is don't look crazy in the eye. And I don't know why. you know, and it's actually, it's again, it's my father, and it actually wasn't it wasn't for the business. It was, you know, but I tend to be sort of a magnet for nuttiness, and so like I've learned, like on the street, like don't look crazy in the eye, because when I catch the eye, suddenly they're like, oh, there's my best friend. I'm going to tell you my, you know,
and that's the title of your autobiography, Marc.
But I think if I could extrapolate that, like why I, because honestly, that's not the best advice I've had for the business, but it's the first thing that popped into my head. And I think where that relates to what we're talking about, though, is that we have had to look crazy in the eye. You can't write a show about authenticity without being authentic. And we've had to have some very hard conversations with tears and painful revelations to one another in order to get to that place. And in answer to what you were saying earlier about the pandemic gave us space and time to be able to actually just be humans together, mm-hmm. and excavate that to be able to try to find a show that truly captures what we wanted, which is something, a subjective experience of Judy from the inside. So
that's great.
And that's my TED Talk. Thank you very much.
And it was worth it. Dennis, when were you the most and the least selfish in your career?
When was I the most selfish and the least selfish in my career?
Yes.
Oh, good heavens, Richard. That was really hard to say.
What happened to no tough questions today?
Well, let me just approach it in a very broad stroke sort of way. I mean, I think in part because the first chapter of my New York experience, the act one of my New York experience was as a performer, and I did a number of Broadway shows, and I really appreciated that time, and I loved it. And when I made the decision to walk away from it, I felt like I was answering another call rather than sort of giving up. I just sort of had found something new that was, you know, very exciting to me, compelling, and something I just wanted to, you know, it was a rainbow I wanted to chase. You know, I would say this doesn't really answer the question, but there is something about being a performer that the act of doing this and getting this at the end of the evening is so fulfilling. It feels, it's just so simple in a way. I mean, obviously you do the whole show, but then at the end of it, your body literally does this, and then all of these people do this, and you feel wonderful. Like the sort of the simplicity of that is something that I think I will always miss. And in a way, I feel like I didn't appreciate it enough. Like I feel like I, in a way, that suggests selfishness in a way. Like I did not at the time think how much I was just going to miss that simple act, because it's different. You know, when you're on the other side of it, like you are rewarded in different ways for the work that you create on that stage. And it's very satisfying and very challenging. And, you know, it is all of those things, but you don't do this and get this. Like, it's just, that's not what you sign up for. So in a way, I feel like I should have appreciated that at the time. And maybe I was just selfish, or I took it for granted. So that really doesn't, it's a two-part, well, right? I'm going to talk too long.
Well, we'll all applaud you now, Dennis.
Okay, I'm going to do this. I'll do that. And then the curtain builds there.
David, what took energy away from you this past week?
Wow. I was, there's just so many things I could talk about. but, you know, the first thing that leaps to mind is Tina Marie and I decided on Sunday, it was a beautiful day. We went to the local gardening store and picked up some beautiful perennials and brought them back to our home. And we planted them in the mulch bed in front of our home. And today I walked out and discovered that when I was using the spade to do that, I cut right, like I completely severed the irrigation line. So I'm going to have to get an irrigation crew to come out and fix that. So that was kind of a bummer.
That'll take energy away from you. Please. That's great.
Yeah, so I guess I'll just, you know, you said also just anything you want to leave me with.
We're going to come back to that. Yeah. So, Tina, what is the one thing about your profession that makes you the angriest and the proudest?
I would say that a lot of the obstacles I've had are not because of who I am, but because who I am not makes me angry, but it also makes me really proud because I have done nothing but break through barriers and overcome obstacles. And when people shit on you, for want of a better word, I continue to rise up. And I'm proud of that, but it makes me so angry that we can't just be celebratory of everybody's successes, that it's such a competitive and finger.
Call me once a week and we'll compare notes. Thank you for saying that. I agree. That's what I'm all about, celebration. You know, we need to celebrate each other more often. So thank you for saying that. And I'm right there with you. And Karen, what scared you this week?
scared me. Probably, I, the one thing, it's not necessarily that it frightened me in a, you know, oh my God, I'm scared way. It was more that it was a jolt of reality. A friend, a good friend of mine passed away.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yesterday. You know, he's been sick for a long time. And those are the moments that you go, especially, you know, at a certain time of your life, when all the friends start to pass away. I've been through a few of these, you know, during the 80s and 90s with friends dying. It's just a little bit of a reality check that it scares you into, you know what, I need to be more serious about the time that I am spending with friends and making that happen and doing things that really mean something to me.
Absolutely. And I'm sorry about the passing of your friend.
Well, thank you.
And Ruby, do you feel that being at this time in your life, that people are appreciating Judy now? I mean, we are now celebrating her 100th birthday. But do you feel that there's a resurgence in terms of the way that people are remembering Judy Garland? And go ahead.
Oh, yeah. I mean, for sure. I think because of the internet, you know, people's tastes are a lot broader than they used to be. 'Cause, you know, we get the exposure. I mean, I remember in my senior year of high school, a GIF of Judy in the good old summertime doing "I Don't Care," circulating. You know, granted, I went to a performing arts school, but I've seen, you know, non-performing arts people like passing along that GIF. So I think she's, yeah, I think, and I know so many people younger than me who are huge Judy Garland fans. You know, I think jazz and swing music, you know, MGM, like it's all come back.
And two things that you just said, Tina, let that be your new theme song. I don't care. I don't care.
It already is.
Happy of summer, everybody. Happy in the good old summertime. So I'm going to bring this up. We're going to do a giveaway, and I will let you know who our winner is going to be. Great names here. Thank you all for being here today. I'm seeing a lot of new names. Sonia Briggs. Sonia, Richard at richardskipper.com. Again, Richard at richardskipper.com. Yay. Send me an email, and after the show, we will decide what your gift is going to be. And it'll be Judy related. So anyway, I want to thank you all for being here. Like I said, you're all going to get a chance to get your final word today. But I want to talk about vision, because I think about all of you and the vision to follow your dreams, just as Judy did. We all know through your show and through her history that how much she wanted to play Dorothy, and she had that vision and it came true. I've been thinking a lot lately about social media, and I've said this on other shows and I'm going to say it now. Social media can be wonderful like this, or it can rip us all apart. And I think about social media, and I think about social and what social really should be about, and socializing and getting together. And I think about social media being three steps that we can all take in building each other up. And Tina just said it beautifully. Let's celebrate each other instead of tearing each other down. When you see a post, especially from your fellow artist, it takes very little effort to hit the like button. Very little effort. Hit the like button, share it, leave a comment, even just to say congratulations. That's all you need to say, congratulations. And then if it's something that's negative or that's something that's going to tear each other down, ask yourself, does it elevate me? Does it elevate that person? Does it elevate the people who are seeing this? And if it doesn't answer those questions, hit the delete button or hide it, so that nobody else sees it, and stop it in its tracks. and we can all be responsible for what we're putting out into the world. And I think that it's important that we all do that. I also end every show by telling everyone to go out and do something nice for somebody else without expecting anything in return. Go to your, and I know, Ruby, you're not on Facebook, so you can do this on Instagram. Go to your, whatever social media platform you're on, and reach out to the sixth person that pops up and reach out with a phone call, not an email message, not a text message, not a private inbox message, but a phone call, and let that person know what they mean to you. As our dear friend Sean Moniger says, we're all in this together, but we're not in the same boat. And I always say, if you're going to go out in a boat, make sure you bring a skipper along. So I'm going to leave the screen, and I'm going to give you the next word, Mark, and then you can pick the next person. But we're going to give Dr. Judi Bloom the final word today. So you'll pick, each person will pick the next person, and then Judy knows how to end the show. So thank you all for being here. I can't wait to see what the next chapter is with Chasing Rainbows. And I will be there cheering you on. And John, thank you. Thank you. That's Judy. John Fricke, if you're watching, thank you for your contribution. And Judy, thank you. So I'm going to leave, and Mark, it's all yours.
So I just have the word. Is that it?
Whatever you'd like to say, a final word to everybody. If you want to, if there's something about yourself coming up that you want to talk about, anything.
No, I'm going to stay on the subject of I don't care. I don't care. Because I had that very image, that meme was something that was shared with me from a friend who just recently died as well. And that was sort of a running joke between the two of us for years. And it was just yet another reminder to connect with the people you love. And I that has been, and to make the most of the time that we have. So I just want to support that idea. I really appreciate and very grateful to Richard for presenting that as a vision. Now, do I disappear myself, or is someone going to disappear me?
Richard will disappear you, but go ahead and pick the next person.
Oh, that's right. Okay, so I'm going to pick Karen Mason, because she plays Kay Coverman. And by the way, this book is about Kay Coverman. It just came out, a biography called She Damn Near Ran the Studio, which is all about her.
I have to go read it.
It's fascinating. It is fascinating. So
I'm coming back on. Who wrote the book? I want to get her on the show.
Jacqueline Breitman is her name.
Great.
Oh, cool.
I'm going to look this up. Thank you for bringing that up. Send me the information.
She damn near ran the studio.
I got to get her on the show. So thank you. Send that to me.
Yeah, you're right. Okay.
Thank you.
All right.
I would like to just continue what Mark said. You know, over the COVID time, I think we all had a lot of time to really look inward, hopefully. And the word connection is very important to me. I've discovered phone calls. I've never been good at phone calls. I always, you know, it's like, man, that's a lot of talking. As a singer, sometimes I get neurotic. Well, as a singer, I am neurotic. And the word connection is very important to me these days. I think, you know, I'd like to continue with that. And I'm going to choose, I'm going with you, Tina Marie.
Awesome. All right. So I'm going to say, the last thing I want to say is, just like the Wizard and the Wizard of Oz, things are not always as they seem. And I think everybody needs to be human and think about how people are more than just their mistakes and more than just their successes. And if we can be forgiving of people who are making mistakes and maybe focus on the good things that they've done, then we might all be a little happier. That's all I'm going to say about that. And I will pass it to David Libby because I think he'll be mad at me if I don't pass it to him.
What? I never get mad at you, Tina Marie. I don't know what you're talking about. Okay, well, you know, listen, this is all of the positive sentiments from Richard forward, I completely agree with and am on board with and echo. And rather than try to extrapolate further, I will actually just say, if you haven't checked out Young Judy Garland, the movies, if you know anybody watching this doesn't know those early movies, I just really want you to check them out, especially songs like Everybody Sing, Meet the Beat of My Heart, all those early songs. They just reveal a whole other dimension, I feel, of Judy that's just so winning. And really, I guess, you know, if I can tie it back to everything that's being said, really just kind of exemplifies all of that positive optimism and energy. And I'm going to pass it over to my oft partner in crime, Ruby Rakos. Take it away, Ruby.
Okay. Well, I think I'm going to bring it back to the show, to Chasing Rainbows. A lot of people ask me, you know, is it hard or do you get nervous, you know, playing Judy Garland, playing someone who is so well known and who is, you know, a legend and the world's greatest entertainer? And the answer is always no, because the show isn't about Judy. It's about Frances, you know, the little girl who's, you know, got a lot of weight on her shoulders trying to hold her family together. And I think her story is really relatable. And it's, you know, she's the girl behind the legend. So no, I don't get nervous because she's, you know, she's her own person.
All right. So Ruby, go ahead and choose Dennis.
Dennis?
Oh, Ruby, thank you. Wow. Well, this has been such a pleasure. I just wanted to thank you so much for having us. You know, something that I'm thinking about, like in terms of the pandemic and what the other folks were kind of sharing, that really, it really sort of brings me back to what one of the things that The Wizard of Oz teaches us, which is that time is precious. We should take nothing for granted, and we should take the time and make important telling those around us that they matter to us and that we love them. The way that Dorothy Gale, you know, arrives back in Kansas and it finally has that precious moment together with her family and her friends to express the importance of home and family, is something I just think, you know, the pandemic really taught us, that you pick up the phone, you know, it is important to tell people that they matter.
There's no place like home.
Yeah, indeed.
Thank you, Dennis.
Great. Thank you for having us.
It was our pleasure. And thank you all for coming tonight. Rainbows. Don't lose the sight of the rainbows in your life. They represent your hopes and your dreams in this very difficult world that we live in. So keep chasing those rainbows. You never know. You might just find that pot of gold. Thanks for being with us. Good night.